Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Nancy Peterson. I think you know that. Today's deacon at First Parish Church Congregational in Manchester by the Sea, Massachusetts. It is my pleasure and privilege, as always, to welcome you here to our spiritual community's weekly time of worship and recommitment to God and God's ways as best expressed for us in the Christian spiritual tradition to the life of Jesus of Nazareth. First Parish Church Congregational, the congregational part of our name signifying our long-standing tradition within Christianity of democratic governance and the full equality of all members of the spiritual community to participate in its life and work. Which means that I welcome you here this morning, whether you are here in person or watching from elsewhere, to this place where no matter who you are or where you are on your life or faith journey, you are fully and completely welcome. Now with that, we welcome back once again our guest minister, Ellie Richardson, who I think needs no introduction. You can read about her in the bulletin. Are there any announcements this morning? Okay. We're all set.
Thank you, Nancy. In the name of our risen Savior, Jesus the Christ, welcome to worship this morning here in the sanctuary and out in cyberspace. Welcome. It is good to be back and to see everyone here this morning on this Veterans Day weekend when we express our gratitude to those who have served in the military in the past and those who are currently serving, and to also thank their families who support them in their service. So thank you all, and we will have a recognition a little bit later on in the service. But I invite you now as we prepare for worship to just take a moment. Take a deep breath. Breathe in the Holy Spirit. Let the Spirit fill you from the tips of your fingers to the tips of your toes. And as you breathe out anything that was bothering you on the way in, any busyness that you had, and allow yourself to be present for the next bit of time that we're together. One more breath, breathe in that Spirit breath, and breathe out. And know that at the end of worship, you can ask God to return whatever was bothering you that you had on your mind or have prepared to do after worship. And maybe you want to leave it with God. God will hold it for you for as long as you need, so you can be present here today and in the coming days. So please join me in the call to worship. God of love, we long for you. We search for you. We wait for you. The world is often dark, and it feels late. There are still those who wait in darkness, so we may share your light with others. God, we open the vessels of our hearts to you. We hold the wick of our hearts to the flame of your love. Fill us with your light. Amen. Please join me by standing in body or spirit and singing the hymn number 451, Be Now My Vision. Thank you.
What a gift and blessing. Thank you so much. We come to our prayer time this morning, and I invite you to share joys and concerns that they may be lifted up to God. Nancy's coming with the microphone.
I'm sitting in Diane Houghton's place because she is not doing so well right now. She went into the hospital unexpectedly Thursday night, and they did all sorts of tests and couldn't find anything, but she thinks, or they think, maybe it was a TIA. Anyway, she would certainly appreciate calls or cards, and she's doing okay. She's just, she said, being in the hospital is no place for somebody who's trying to get any sleep. So she was exhausted by the time she got home. So she's doing okay, and they couldn't find anything. So that's the good news. So just pray for her. Diane Houghton, in whose spot I'm sitting.
Thank you. So prayers for Diane.
An update on Muriel, please. Continued prayers would be much appreciated. She remains at Addison Gilbert Hospital in pulmonary edema. She wants to turn 100 and is hoping to have an aortic valve replacement as soon as her very, very low sodium level comes up. So everybody eat a potato chip in her honor today, please.
God bless her. When is her 100th birthday?
June.
I just want to say hello to George and Betsy Nicholas, wherever they are, with the hopes that they might be checking in today. I don't know if anyone's been following their blog, their journey blog, as they kind of travel the world together. But it's just weird not having them here, and I just wanted to say their names out loud. So we love you guys wherever you are.
I hope you're having a wonderful adventure. Traveling the country.
I would like to just raise, a couple of times I've raised Rob Pepper that I was looking for housing for, and he has found an apartment right here in town, right down by the bank, which is perfect for him. So he's all set. Prayers were answered. Thank you.
Hallelujah.
I'd like you all to consider prayers for the families of the Israeli hostages that are being held by Hamas and the awful trauma that they are experiencing, as well as the hostages themselves.
Absolutely. There is a lot of horror happening across the world. Others? I also invite us to hold in prayer all those affected by war, all of the innocents, the lives that are being impacted on either side, and that the world leaders open their hearts to God's wisdom, and we all pray for peace, that someday this country, this world, can find ways to love one another and to realize that we are all God's children, and that we are here as stewards for this earth. We don't own pieces of it. We are stewards to care for it throughout our lifetime to pass it on to future generations. Please join me in the spirit of prayer this morning. Holy and loving God, we are indeed a stubborn and impatient people. We always want to know how things will end. We want to know what the schedule is. We want a daily planner from you so we can be ready. But it's interesting, you've already given us a daily planner. The Holy Spirit, who you gave to us to give us comfort and to guide us, is our daily planner. We are called daily to come before you in prayer and praise. And each day we're challenged to find ways to serve your people in the world. And sometimes we do acknowledge this. But we would still like to know when we need to have all the oil for our lamps ready. Holy One, why is it so difficult for us to be continually ready? Is it because we've placed you to one side in our lives? And when we think you're coming, we take our faith down from the shelf and dust it off? Help us to place you at the center of our lives. seeking to prepare ourselves every day for your coming again in glory. As we have brought before you the names of those people who are near and dear to us, and those who are around the world suffering, we ask your healing love and blessing for them. Their needs are great and our abilities are so limited. But we know that with your love, all things are possible. Give us such courage and perseverance that we may faithfully proclaim your love to all creation. Make us ready to receive you now in this place and everywhere we are. For it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hear us now as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught the disciples long ago, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I invite Mary Ellen Cook to come forward for a stewardship moment.
Good morning, everybody. Literally, I think I'm preaching to the choir today. This is our fifth week talking about the Stewardship Annual Fund Drive. And usually I get up here and I have no notes, so I kind of wing it. But I changed, during the week, I've changed everything I've wanted to say, and this morning I totally have turned it around in my head. So I thought I would start with quickly how I got on stewardship, because I'll never forgive Lully for this one. But anyway, years ago, Lully kept at me for joining stewardship, and I had always said, no stewardship, no trustees for me. No money. I don't want to do anything having to do with money. But she kept up, and so I did. And then Paul Gudonis was the chair, and he was lovely. And then there was the nudge when he left. So here I am. What I have learned over the time is it's not about money. Stewardship is not about money. It's about our faith. It's about our giving. So a few years ago, we had a coach who I love dearly, Paul Nickerson. But when we were talking about our stewardship annual fund drive, he said, people don't know what stewardship means. Take stewardship off the term, off your drive. Call it the annual fund drive. People will relate to it more. So we did. Whether they did or they didn't relate to it more, I don't know. But then we got Muriel Parker in our congregation. And Muriel said to me a couple years ago, I don't like this. It should be the stewardship annual fund drive. You're taking the whole purpose away. Because stewardship is about our faith, and we're different than giving to the animal shelter annual fund drive or other kinds of fund drives. We're a church, and we do things for God, whether they're with our time, with our money, with our donations. So forgetting that when I gave the literature this year to Nancy, our first blurb that came in the bulletin was the annual fund drive 2024. And who comes up after service and kind of nudges me, Muriel, did you forget? So immediately, everything has been changed. We're back to stewardship annual fund drive. And we've been talking for a month about your dreams for First Parish Church in 2024. And those dreams, some of them are free. Some of your visions are free. But the rest do cost money to run our buildings, our salaries, our missions, our programs. So when you're thinking about pledging to First Parish Church, please give generously, give from your heart. If you don't know about pledging, please talk to me. And give any way you want. Credit cards, checks, in the plate, any way you want. But just give. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary Ellen. Mary Ellen is a wise woman. Absolutely. And now we come to the time for our offering. Whether you have a penny to put in the plate or wealth beyond imagination, God appreciates it all, and God will grow it. God will grow it to serve the world in this community in ways we have but to imagine. Give generously and give from your heart whatever you are able to give. The morning offering will now be received. Yes, our deacons are not coming forward today. Oh, here they come. Here comes Nancy. Thought we lost you. Please join me in the prayer of dedication. Discerning God, receive our offerings and gifts for your kingdom. Let them be a blessing to those in need of encouragement, material goods, and evidence of your presence among us. Magnify them beyond our imagining. Grant us insight into the possibilities before us for ministry and witness. We are grateful to give. Amen.
Nancy, are you going to read the scripture? Are you going to read the scripture?
All right, this morning's scripture is Matthew chapter 25, verses 1 to 13. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 young women took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them became drowsy and slept. But at midnight, there was a shout, "Look, here is the bridegroom. Come out to meet him." Then all those young women got up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out." But the wise replied, "No, there will not be enough for you and for us. You had better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves." And while they went to buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the other young women came also, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But he replied, "Truly I tell you, I do not know you. Keep awake, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour."
Thank you, Nancy. Please pray with me. Holy and loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight this and every day, for you are indeed our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Okay, here we are. Yet another parable from Matthew. Now, I love the parables, but even I'm getting a little bit weary. And we have more to go. Three parables before Advent begins on December 3rd. All they talk about is the second coming of Christ and a day of judgment. And yet there are textual problems with them and theological differences of opinion on what they mean. But in reading this one and preparing the message this week, I had some new insights. First, I began contemplating the wedding that those young women were in. If you've ever planned a wedding, you know that there are lots of details involved, from the design of the invitation to the table decorations to the cake and everything in between. Nobody wants to forget any of the details. You want to make the day as perfect as possible. And if you've ever been a bridesmaid or a groomsman, you know what certain details fall to your plate. One of the main ones is to take care that attention is never diverted from the wedding couple to you. Our modern-day wedding customs would have sounded very strange to the people in Jesus' time. Back then, wedding festivities lasted about 7 days. It was a whole week. And the processions of the bride and groom marked the beginning of the celebration. The scene in today's parable finds the young women waiting for the groom's arrival. It was their big moment. It was their special duty to have lamps prepared for this procession. They were to wait for the groom either at the bride's house where the groom would come and fetch her, or at the home of his family where the celebration and the ceremony would actually take place. All of them had lamps. They were going to lead the wedding party in this great procession through the village. Unlike our weddings that are supposed to start at a specific time, and there are plenty of stories to tell about when that didn't happen. Some of you probably have your own stories about that. In Jesus' day, it was unusual for there to be a delay. There could be, and oftentimes were, last-minute negotiations between the groom and the bride's family over the gifts that were to be exchanged or the dowry. And the story doesn't explain the delay, but it wouldn't have been uncommon. The young women would have known that a delay could occur, so they would be ready whenever. The parable describes the debacle of 5 young women who missed the procession and undoubtedly incurred the wrath of the bride and groom and their families and all the other wedding guests because they weren't there and they were expected to be. Can you imagine if half of the bridesmaids at a wedding today didn't show up prepared? If this was a morality tale, the moral of the story would be don't mess up your friend's wedding. Yet we know that parables are more than that. There's always at least one deeper meaning to be mined from what at first seems like a straightforward cautionary tale. And frankly, to tell you the truth, I'm relieved that there's more to this story. To begin with, the wise young women sound like mean girls to me, or at least selfish ones. Instead of sharing their oil, they send the others out to try and find oil. No shops would have been open that night. They would have had to bang on doors of friends and relatives and shopkeepers begging for their help. Really? I don't think of any other place in the Bible where such selfish behavior is called wise. Please let me know if you can find one. They say, we can't share because we might not have enough for ourselves. Just to be safe, we're not sharing what we have.
Can't you just hear it? It seems like they were operating out of scarcity and fear. We know that what that looks like. I think if we go back to the beginning of the pandemic back in 2020, they might have been amongst those who were hoarding toilet paper and hand sanitizer and probably still have a stash somewhere in their basement. And they call those the wise ones. And I don't have a lot of sympathy for the foolish ones either. They should have known better. They should have been prepared. They shouldn't have listened to the mean girls and gone off in search of that oil. Surely they knew that the groom was approaching, and it was too late to go shopping. Their foolishness guaranteed that by the time they got back, they'd be left out in the dark. The groom probably thought he'd been deserted by his foolish friends when he finally arrived. Maybe he thought they'd simply given up and gone home. After all, it was cold and dark. It was nighttime. And can you imagine what happened when the bride heard about it? Did she know that when the foolish five did show up, her groom barred the door and wouldn't let them in? It seems like there was a lot of foolishness going on both sides that night. The only distinction between the wise and the foolish ones was their preparation. Five were ready when the groom arrived, five weren't. They all were judged on the basis of how well prepared they were. Like many of the parables, we squirm a little when we really listen to it. Parables are supposed to make us a little uncomfortable. If we're honest with ourselves, our discomfort comes when we acknowledge that we can relate to both the wise and the foolish ones, and sometimes even the groom. Truth be told, I've been one of the foolish ones whose lamps have run out. I've been amongst the wise ones who feared sharing and losing what they had. I've been the bridegroom who refused to let people in. And maybe that's what this parable does. It allows us to really see ourselves. That may be why this parable is so troublesome. It creates a stark duality of either you're wise or you're foolish. Either you're ready or you're not. Either you're in or you're out. But we know we're more complex than that. And I'm pretty sure that God knows that too. Recognizing ourselves in all of these characters can go a long way in making us better disciples. So when you find yourself feeling foolish like the foolish young women, stop and wait in the darkness. Don't run from it. It can be a holy place where God can meet you and transform you. When you find yourself feeling like the wise young women tempted to hoard what you have, stop and remember to share, even if it scares you that you might not have enough. And when you find yourself feeling like the bridegroom, angrily closing the door against others or building barriers to keep certain people out, stop and open the door to that banquet feast. The other troubling thing about this parable is it just doesn't sound like Jesus. The separation between those who are in and those who are out is in stark contrast to the inclusive nature of Jesus throughout the gospel. So what's going on here? Let's go back to the time when Matthew was writing this gospel. Shortly before Matthew wrote the gospel, the destruction of Jerusalem happened. Its temple was destroyed in 70 in the Common Era. It was a time of terrible turmoil, and the religious leaders were trying to figure out how to maintain their community, their religious identity, even their theology that had tied the very presence of God to that temple. I think we can relate somewhat to that. Keeping the congregation together during turmoil of the pandemic, wondering what the future of the church will be now that we're back in the building, kind of reminds you of what was going on back then, 2,000 years ago. What the leaders back then were doing was clamping down on the strands of Judaism that didn't fit into what they deemed to be the correct expression of the faith. They were drawing lines of who was in and who was out. And among others, those Jews who were part of the Jesus movement were most definitely out. Matthew and his community understandably didn't take that well. In turn, Matthew tells a story about how Jesus would probably have responded to these religious leaders. The tables would have been turned, and they would be the ones cast out when Jesus came back to establish the kingdom of God. There have been centuries of Christians ever since who have been waiting hopefully for Jesus' second coming. Unfortunately, this idea has created theology that abandons the earth to the powers and principalities of the world while looking heavenward for divine rescue. That kind of dualistic thinking has created a mindset and policies of injustice and ecological destruction. And again, we're challenged to think bigger and understand that we need to be both heavenly-minded and earthly good. There's much scholarly disagreement about whether Jesus himself was an apocalyptic preacher that is concerned with the end times and judgment day, and whether he would come back to lead what John Dominic Crossan calls the great cleanup, when God would step in and clean up the earth, bringing a new creation where justice and peace would reign. Some believe that the second coming has already happened at Pentecost. Others say that Jesus is continually appearing among us and leading us, sometimes pushing us into the kingdom of God right here and right now. I don't think it ultimately matters as long as we hold to what Jesus taught us about the kingdom of God. Jesus didn't promote division, but encouraged a oneness with God. Jesus promoted loving our neighbors. That's all our neighbors. The characters in the parable are useful to us in holding up a mirror to ourselves to see where we're not as well prepared as we could be, not as generous as we could be, not as welcoming as we could be. The parable can challenge us and lead us into better discipleship, knowing that Jesus is always coming to us. We don't have to wait for a great divine cleanup to experience the kingdom of God. If that's true, then we have our work cut out for us, loving and welcoming our neighbors, yes, all of our neighbors, feeding the hungry, sharing generously from the bounty we have had, opening doors, taking down barriers that have been built between those who are in and those who are out. In these tumultuous days, we've been hearing a lot about healing the divisions in our nation and in our world. That's how now the challenge to us as followers of Jesus. How will we foster this in ourselves, in our congregation, in our communities, and in the world? It's a big question, probably not one that we can answer today. Thankfully, there are more apocalyptic parables to keep us at it over the next couple of weeks. But for now, remember Jesus' words from Luke's gospel, "The kingdom of God is among you." And from the gospel of Thomas, "The kingdom of God is within you." Remember, Jesus can come to you at any time. Be as prepared as you can be. But most of all, be open to the wonderment and surprising possibilities that Jesus will bring to you and through you. Stay tuned. To be continued. Amen.
At 11 o'clock in the morning, on November 11th, 1918, an armistice was signed by the Allies and the Germans, ending World War I. A year later, in 1919, Woodrow Wilson, on that first Armistice Day, set aside that day to honor our veterans and active military people for the future, giving them thanks and gratitude for their dedication to our country and service that we may be free. So this morning, on this Veterans Weekend, we honor those who have served, who are serving, and their families. Bethany is going to join me as we honor them. So I invite those of you who are veterans of any of the armed services, any of those of you who are currently serving, widows of veterans, and family members of those who may currently be serving, to stand as we offer our gratitude to you for all you have given on behalf of our country. For it is not only those who have served, but the families who watch and wait as you stand behind. So please rise as you are able and accept our gratitude. Yes, please say your name, your service, and the area you served in.
Thank you for sharing. And who is the family? This is for my youngest brother, Charlie Mercurio, currently deployed in the Army.
Jim Brennan, Vietnam, 1967 to 1970.
Which branch of service?
Army.
Henry Lapple, the Navy, the Atlantic.
Thank you for your service on behalf of this congregation.
I have something to say.
Go for it.
A thought for everybody about war. War is worse than hell. There are no innocent victims in hell. And that's about how I feel about it. War is the most terrible thing on this earth of ours. People live and die. And they still fight on no matter what. War will never end. And it is I wish with all I have there was an end to war. And God bless everybody who ever fought in it.
Amen.
And God bless this nation.
Amen.
And everybody in it. And all you good people. God bless you all too.
Thank you, friend.
And I love saying that. Here who know what I mean by it.
Yes.
It means I love you all. God bless America.
I want to honor my dad who fought in World War II, Arthur Johnson. He's in the Army.
Liz.
I'd like to honor my husband, Rich, who was in the Navy in Vietnam.
Paul is upstairs. I understand, Paul, you are a veteran.
Yes, I'm a veteran, and actually, it goes way back to my grandmother, who was in World War I, worked at the Althouse. My dad was in World War II. My brother, my older son Michael, and myself have all served in the Air Force.
Thank you for your
service.
It certainly is, and thank you for your service for all of them.
And Richard, too.
And Richard, you're also a veteran, I understand. Where did you, when did you serve and what branch? Thank you for your service. We have plenty of flags for you to have, and for those of you who would like a flag, oh, we have somebody else down front.
So many, many of us had a parent who served. That might be interesting to ask. Who?
How many of you had parents who served? Yeah. I had four uncles and an aunt who served in World War II, one who was killed in action.
Yeah.
A cousin, Josh, who served in Afghanistan, and because of his PTSD, committed suicide 4 years ago. And God bless all of the veterans for what you've gone through and what you carry with you. And to all of the families who have stayed behind, keeping the home fires burning, worrying about them each and every day. So there will be flags for anybody that would like one. We'll have them out in the narthex for you afterwards. You're welcome to join me in prayer, either speaking this prayer aloud or to let the words fill your soul and flow over you and around you. Loving God, we come to you today filled with gratitude and humbled by our freedom, for we know that freedom is not free. In order to grant our country's freedom, millions of men and women have submitted their lives to serve on our behalf. We are deeply indebted to them, and we pray they feel our gratitude for all they have done for us. Help us remember the sacrifice of every man and woman in our armed forces. Their service meant a commitment to our country and to us. Let us celebrate their willingness to lay their lives down for their friends, the greatest act of love. Help us to remember that their service meant sacrifice, time spent away from loved ones, eyes that cannot unsee war, and memories that do not seem to fade. Loving God, we may not know the hardships they have endured, but you do. You see all. You know all. You are with all. We pray that these men and women would cast their burdens on you and find everlasting peace in your presence. Let our hearts be stirred by the selflessness of our veterans. Let this sacrifice motivate us to serve one another as they have served us. Gracious God, help us remember the sacrifices of their families, the parents and partners who exchanged last hugs before deployments, never knowing if they would see their loved one again, the parents raising children of our military personnel, willingly taking on the role of both mother and father, the partners and kids who wait patiently by the door day after day, just waiting for their hero to come back home. Freedom is not free, and the weight of our veterans' service also fell on their families. Help us remember those who serve today and their active role in defending our nation. Heavenly Father, we ask for your protection over them. We pray that they know your presence is always with them. We pray that you would open our eyes to see the needs of veterans in our communities. Open our mouths to uplift our veterans with honor and kindness. Open our hands in generosity to serve and care for them. Let us not be too busy or too distracted to honor those sacrifices. Help us to keep our eyes fixed on the day when the world will know no more war, when your peace will sweep over our lands and finally heal our brokenness. Oh God, we long for that day. Yet, for now, we offer our gratitude and prayers in the name of our Savior Jesus. Amen. Let us join our voices together, rising in body or spirit, and singing hymn number 576, For the Healing of the Nations. Look upon you with kindness and grant you peace this and every day of your life. You've been nourished and fed, I pray, this day. Now go from this place and be the church. Wherever you go, you are prepared to be the church on the beach, on a boat, on the playground, at work, at home. You never know when you may see Jesus looking back at you, or you may be representing Jesus to someone else. Share the love of God every moment of your life, for you are a beloved child.
Go now in peace. Amen.
God bless you and keep you.